Hi everyone, and we're back live here at the Guidewell Insights Lounge. This is Kate Warnock coming to you on location from the floor of the 2017 AHIP Institute and Expo. I am delighted to have a very distinguished guest with us, Mr. Charles Steller. Charles, welcome to the interview.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here.
We are so happy to have you. Charles has just a little bit of history with the AHIP organization. Why don't you tell us about what that was, and then tell us what you're doing with yourself these days.
Certainly. First of all, you know, with the health plans and with AHIP, it's been sort of my entire career.
Okay.
And it's since the early 80s, even back in the late 70s with predecessor organizations.
Okay.
So the great thing is I've watched the evolution and health plans working with consumers, health mm-hmm. plans working with providers, some of the issues that we experienced in interoperability.
Mm-hmm.
And today I'm with WEDI, which is the Work Group for Electronic Data Interchange.
That's right.
It's a great opportunity now to put it all together.
And you're the president and CEO of WEDI.
That's correct.
That's right. And you even came out of retirement to take that position, I understand.
Right. I think that taking a couple pictures of butterflies and sending them to friends created some, like, you need to go back to work.
Okay. But clearly something you're passionate about, Charles. So I know WEDI is happy and blessed to have you.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I would like to sort of see, before I retire permanently, I would like to see many of these issues and problems become non-issues.
Well, let's talk about one of the big issues, Charles, prior authorization. Okay. So recent change in HHS leadership and the call for prior authorization reform sweeping our industry, it seems that we're at a point to really start talking more about prior authorization, bolstering dialogue, I should say, between payers and providers. Okay. What are some of the ways payers and providers can be brought together to not only discuss reform, but bring feedback on the topic of prior authorization?
Sure. We certainly hear a lot about this at WEDI. We had a great deal of discussions about prior authorization before I left AHIP. You know, there was a fair amount of, well, it's the problem of the providers, from the provider perspective, no, it's the payers. And so it was somewhat finger pointing.
Yeah.
But the fact remains, when I went to WEDI, since providers, payers, are all part of our membership and governance. So we have the dialogue there as well as the government on our board of directors. So now I see, okay, well, let's get it all together. We can make it work.
Right.
So with prior authorization for we decided that we needed, in addition to the work group that we've had for several years at WEDI, we needed to maybe bring everyone together. So as a result, we established the Prior Authorization Council.
Okay.
And our objective was to find all of the various projects from organizations, provider organizations, looking at the AMA principles,
yeah.
looking at the work of whether it's X12, HL7, the cooperative exchange, looking at all of the NCPDPs and WEDI and saying, you know, and the work of HIMSS, let's put it all together and let's see about getting the group together. And let's figure out where we have common areas of
right.
interest, issues, and where we might be able to come up with some solutions.
So you're really taking a collaborative approach. You're bringing all the stakeholders together, and you're providing that forum, that council that you mentioned, is really that place that it can really be kind of hashed through, which I know that doesn't, we don't always have that kind of governing infrastructure to provide a place for people to come together. So what a wonderful opportunity.
This is a great opportunity.
Yeah.
It's also one of the it's a fascinating process, because you see that everyone, no matter which side, they want to see us come to a conclusion that is much better between provider and payer, and that make sure that the consumer is in no way getting hurt by this process, that we are putting the patient first.
Right.
And we're really, that is our goal, not to have discussions about, you know, who's right or wrong.
Right. Moving beyond the finger pointing.
Absolutely. Right. It's a great opportunity to put the technology process in action. You put the you look at processes to see where you may have some problems in your process, in your prior authorization process, and you try to come up with some solutions.
All right, we're going to pivot a little bit away from prior authorization. We're going to start talking about, you know, the move away from fee for service and more towards the alternative payment models. It really requires a vast exchange of clinical information. I think from your perspective, I'd like to know, is HHS going to mandate standards and protocols for clinical information exchange?
Well, there's a couple, you know, I would suspect that will come in time. For purposes of right now, I think we're still trying to, HHS is establishing their priorities.
And new administration.
And trying to really, and with Dr. Price, he's trying to look at the electronic health records and some of the obstacles that we have in collecting information. And then that's going to lead us into, well, how do we share information?
Right.
And what are the obstacles? There's people in throughout this exhibit hall that are here as, you know, they have various solutions. And in these solutions that, you know, how do you transfer clinical data? What is the additional information? Sometimes the exhibitor has a product that helps us with our current process do it better.
All right.
But let's clean it up. Let's find a way that we can exchange data, we protect the data, it's secure.
Right.
The patient is in charge of the data.
Yes.
And because the interesting part of it is our data.
Right. You know, I have to tell you, Charles, we had Dr. Farzad Mastashari was with us beginning. He kicked off our live stream in day one, and he was wearing this lapel pin, and it showed a download icon, and it really was about it's all about people owning their own data.
Right.
And I think that that's such a critical part of WEDI's mission, too, is figuring out how to enable that sort of transfer of power. That's really what it is.
It really is.
Yeah.
And to make sure that it's done in a way that the consumer has to also be careful how the information is used,
sure.
who has access to it, making certain that you know, you protect your own data,
right.
but certainly anyone who handles your data, that it is done so in a way that we can, as much as we can, assure that no one else is using the data or using the data inappropriately.
Right. You know, I you lead me into my next question perfectly. You know, in this era of digital health, we have this proliferation of digital health applications. You know, what are your concerns as millions of people begin to load their personal and clinical data into these apps?
This is a significant issue.
Yeah.
It's an issue because we trust an app, and we now realize that when we download to an email that we're getting, that we sometimes find out that is, people are just, you know, trying to collect your information,
yes.
scan
yeah.
your information.
Yeah.
Well, with apps, we really don't know what's behind a particular app. You know, what is sort of the standards they've gone through? Why is it that, you know, they are now sort of authorized to take all of our information?
Yeah.
And we're authorizing them to do it. So I think there's part of it is, how can we have a process to make sure that we have accredited apps?
Yeah.
Maybe one way?
Yeah.
Where we actually tie it together that says, I have apps, my apps are apps that will help me better take care of my own health care,
mm-hmm.
and help me with my providers. But let's make sure that we're not opening up our information right. to the wrong people.
Right.
And so, you know, there a process of sort of determining, deeming the apps that are part of, that we decide to partner with, we as a consumer.
Yeah.
We've got to have some assurance that we are only using the right ones.
So is there any kind of effort underway for that kind of that verification that, you know, some sort of qualified app, it gets a check mark of some, is that happening now?
There are processes. There's some various people, some even in this exhibit hall.
Okay.
That believe that we have to do something about the quality of the apps, the use of how apps can actually pull your information, and are they storing your information, or are they just pulling the information they need to report back on
right.
on your
right.
your exercise program,
right? Right.
Or are they using it and possibly going too far on it? So there's organizations, there are people that have this as a desire that I've talked with that really want to make sure that we have only qualified apps that we're working with.
Right. Great to have those consumer safeguards in place.
Absolutely.
It makes so much sense. I've got one last question
sure.
for you, Charles. So you have, as you mentioned, decades of experience, and you've been through multiple administrations, different kind of health reforms, you know, really seen this industry evolve and grow. Tell us, what do you think health plans should be focusing on in the next 12 to 18 months?
I think that health plans and providers, and but let's just use health plans,
okay.
since you raised that issue.
Yeah.
They are focusing on the consumer.
Rightly so.
We are the ones
yeah.
that are driving the information, and so number one, we think that it will be a more consumer focused.
Okay.
Depending upon how they purchase the care, whether it's done, you know, through their employer, whether it's done on the exchange, mm-hmm. or some variation thereof, but certainly. You need the health plan is going to want to make sure that they are connected in with the consumer. The consumer has access to the information. They're able to transfer information that the consumer needs to better manage their own health care.
Yeah.
So it needs to be more of a partnership.
Yeah.
And I think that's what I see as one of the bright stars of the future.
I do too, and we've certainly had a lot of speakers reiterate that point. So, Charles, it was delightful having you here.
Thank you so much.
In the Guidewell Insights Lounge, thank you for sharing your time and your expertise with us.
My delight.
Yes.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Well, listen, everyone, we're going to be up with another interview in just a few minutes. I hope you keep watching.